Hello, this is Allie with the Perception Trainers, author of The Perception Diet, and today we are going to talk about who are you to think that you deserve to find a path in life that you love? Okay, so I actually get this question all the time in the people that I work with or, you know, just in general, like friends and family and people in my life, and maybe even I thought this way at one point in my life. And it's essentially this idea of like, who the heck do I think that I am that I should be able to find like a life and a career and a job and all this stuff that I love and enjoy when there are so many people out there who have to work shitty jobs or who just, you know, are responsible adults who just kind of like show up to their shitty job and like make money and pay their bills and get shit done and just like live their lives. And I think in a lot of ways too, this thinking tends to kind of come up when people are starting to question society and question how things work, and they start to really like look into things and maybe why we do the things that we do, and we start to think, oh, well, like, maybe I don't want to be doing this, like, I hate my job, I hate my life, I hate all this stuff, and I really want to discover something new, I want to do something better, I want to love what I'm doing or whatever. And then either it's an internal voice or an external voice comes and tells you, like, who the fuck do you think you are to deserve a happy life? Like, who do you think you are to think that you deserve to live your passion and get paid for it? Like, who are you to, you know, step outside the bounds of what everyone else is doing, which is just get a job, pay your bills, be a responsible adult, and get on with it? And like I say, this can come from an internal voice, right? Or more likely, this is going to come from an external voice. You may have a person of an older generation say something to you like that, like, you know, well, I just went, like, I didn't love my job, and I just did what I needed to do to provide for my kids, or, like, to provide for you, if that's your mom or dad, to, you know, be a responsible adult so I could pay my taxes and afford my house and afford my car and do the things that a responsible adult is supposed to do. And today, I really want to look at whether or not this model that we have in society of what makes someone a responsible adult is actually true. If this is actually what makes somebody a responsible adult. And if not, why not? And how we might be able to look at this differently. Okay, so bottom line is the world has been run by fear for a very, very, very long time, right? Human beings have been making their decisions and making their choices and making their life path choices based off of a place of fear for a very, very long time. So essentially, like, I'm going to kind of go on and say a couple of other things. And of course, we could say that, yes, this fear thing started way before what I'm going to say. But for the purposes of this video and kind of where we are right now in human history, this is kind of what applies, all right? So back in the days in and around World War I and World War II, right? If people weren't already living in a really kind of locked down state of fear at that, before that, by the time World War started happening, people were in lockdown and people were in fear, right? Because the world was going crazy. And security was, and safety and all this stuff was just completely up in the air, right? The way that the world was, it was unpredictable. We didn't know what dictators were gonna do. There were genocides, there were huge mass murders, and all this stuff was happening. And like I say, I know that before the world wars, this stuff was happening. Indigenous cultures were being wiped out. Like, this fear thing was already happening on a mass scale. But what happened in the world wars is that essentially it started to touch everyone, even if it wasn't affecting you personally in your day-to-day life, right? So like I say, like, there were these mass genocides and all this stuff happening way before the world wars, of course. But if it wasn't happening to you, if it wasn't happening to your tribe, if it wasn't happening to your people group, you probably weren't hearing about it. You weren't living it. It wasn't a part of your reality. Whereas by the time the World War I and World War II came around, like I said, it was basically affecting everybody. Like, or a much larger people group. So even though, like, the war wasn't necessarily happening here in America or in Canada or whatever, we saw it. We knew that it was happening, and it did have an effect because we were moving towards being more and more of a global society back then, right? So this fear thing set in even more intensely than it ever had before, because it was really like security and safety and predictability were being ripped away from everybody, right? And so then, especially in the Western world, in the developed world, we started to get this idea that, right, from this state of fear came this idea of just get security, right? So our grandparents' generation, the generation before the baby boomers, the wartime people, right, they were simply living their life just trying to kind of scrape it together, put things together, recover from the crazy insanity that was the world wars. They either were participating in the war or their parents participated in the war. They were literally directly affected by the wars, and it was a horrible thing, right? And then they gave birth to the baby boomer generation, who, again, like I've talked about in many videos, it's like the world was coming back into a relative state of sanity, quote unquote, versus the world war situation, right? However, because their parents were so afraid and there was still so much fear, everything was built upon this foundation of fear. America was built on a foundation of fear. Canada was built on a foundation of fear, right? Like, not only was it stolen land from literally genocide of massive amounts of people groups, which already is a huge thing of fear, we were then like, okay, the job now is to create economic stability and stability for the people, so like hunker down, make it safe, right? And so on the whole and on the individual level, right, government started making everything about national security, and people started to simply focus on just do whatever you have to do to nail in that security. And for a period of time, because everything, even when it's totally out of alignment, if the aggregate agrees on it and enough, we can make it happen, right? So for a period of time, the world actually did work that way. You could go to school, get a job, or like go to university or go to college or whatever, get a job, stay in that job for the next 40 or 50 years, slowly climb the ladder, the corporate ladder, right? You were going to get a raise every couple of years, and then you were going to get a pension, and you were going to retire, and you would have your retirement savings, and that would be your life. And that was your nice, secure, clean life, right? And maybe you didn't love what you did, right? That people weren't really focused on that at the time. They were really focused on just get the security so that I can provide for myself and my family and kind of fuck the rest of the world, fuck the rest of the people. This mindset came in with this, and we'll talk about that as we go on, and just do what I need to do for myself. Okay, so now the world doesn't work like that anymore. Okay, my generation, the people who were born after the baby boomers, and everyone after us, the millennials, whatever you want to call us, we have been born into this world that is actually quite paradoxical, right? So our parents and our grandparents still believe that security is a thing. And just be a responsible adult, go get a job, go work at that job, put your head down, sit down and shut up and do your work, and you'll have security and you'll be fine. Okay, but the thing is that the world has changed and that doesn't exist anymore, right? There are hundreds of thousands of people who have gone to university, gotten degrees, that should have, you know, maybe in times past, would have gotten them a job and literally guaranteed them security for the rest of their life. And now they're basically walking out into the world and those jobs don't exist. And that security doesn't exist. And that I'm just going to step into a job and work it for the next 40 years is, like, that is slowly starting to disappear. Okay? And on because of that, like, you know, we're a little bit more awake, we're a little bit more aware, we're a little bit less in fear because we haven't experienced what our parents and our grandparents experienced. There's still something inside of us that wants growth and expansion. Okay, so now we need to look at that state of fear that our grandparents and our parents were in, the baby boomers and the great generation. What the state of fear that they were in, what that created, right? We understand this from, again, Dr. Bruce Lipton's work. Go look him up. Just like in the cell, when we are in a state of fear as a human being, growth and expansion are not possible. You cannot evolve with the times. You cannot change. You cannot grow. You cannot expand. You cannot adapt when you are in a state of fear. You also can't think about other people. You're on lockdown, and all you can do is maintain the status quo. Now, what we know about life, actual life, natural law, how it works, is natural law requires growth and expansion. Life requires growth and expansion. Nature is always growing. There is no such thing as staying somewhere, okay? You're either growing, and if you're not growing and expanding, you're in a state of lockdown, which eventually causes death and destruction. Those are the two states. You can't be holding steady somewhere and expecting to thrive. Okay? And this is an important thing to understand. When we are in a state of fear, we can do stagnation for a while. We can do security for a while. But from that consciousness, okay, means growth, evolution, expansion, creativity, all of these things are not possible. Right? Best case scenario, you can maintain what's happening. Worst case scenario, you start to degrade. Because here's the thing. Even if you are in a place where you're trying to create security for yourself and create a stable place for yourself, that's not how life works. Okay? Life is going to keep moving on. The universe and everything, consciousness, keeps expanding. So it's like being in a river that's flowing and you are desperately holding on to the shore so that you don't move, right? The best thing that can happen in that position is you're going to get just really tired holding on to the shore, right? So this is what's happened. The world has changed. Things have shifted. The climate has changed. The economic climate has changed. The industrial climate has changed, right? 20, 30, 40 years ago, you could go get a job in a factory. Now we have technology that has replaced that, okay? So if you were in a state of lockdown and you got a job in a factory and you thought you were going to work at that factory for the rest of your life and this was a stable job, and then all of a sudden technology came along and made your job redundant, if you are not in a state of love and expansion where you can grow and change and adapt to the new world, you are out of a job. Because the thing is, you're going to sit there and you're going to wait for life to go back to the way that it was, because that's all you know is your status quo. You're going to be stuck in your old thing, in trying to keep everything the same, and you're only going to be able to do that, so then when the world shifts, you're not going to be able to adapt, okay? And again, this is a problem. This is the problem, is this constant obsession with security and with just making my money for myself so that I have my little piece of whatever life that's stable and secure for myself, is what is causing all the problems we see on the planet today. So, and then the second thing, because when you are not in a state of growth, when you are in a state of fear and you are in a state of lockdown and you're in a state of just find security, just find the job that's secure, think of what that thinking is actually all about, right? That's about getting money, getting security, like getting this illusory sense of safety for yourself. All you can think about is yourself, and it blocks you from foresight, right? It blocks you from thinking of the bigger picture. It blocks you from thinking of anybody else because it's all about just making yourself feel safe. So what have been the results of the previous two generations working so hard for personal and even, you know, societal security. What has happened is a massive disparity of wealth, where some people, even though they have so much more than they need, continue to need to acquire more and more and more of the resources, more and more and more of the power, more and more and more, because they never feel secure. They never feel safe enough. It has equaled massive, crazy imbalances in the world where we are so afraid of each other that we create these wars and these battles and these terrorist attacks and blah, 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 because we're so afraid of everybody all the time, right? We're like literally paranoid because of this. You're like, everyone thinks that everyone else is a threat to security. So we're constantly just like warring against each other. And it's made it so that as things have changed, as technology has advanced, as all these things have changed, people aren't able to adapt. They are literally drains on the system because they are no longer relevant, right? They don't have relevant skills anymore. They don't have relevant, they are not expanding along with it. So then they become obsolete parts of society, technically speaking, just as far as, you know, again, the broken system of monetary value, which is silly anyways, but keeping with that system, people fall out of being a productive part of that system, and then, like I say, they no longer are able to procure security for themselves, right? So like I say, it's created this massive disparity where there are some people who just keep accumulating, 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 and other people that just have no, like, less and less and less and less and less, waiting for things to go back to the way that they were, more and more people becoming redundant because their jobs are being technologically gotten rid of and they're not able to adapt because they're in a state of lockdown and just trying to keep everything the same way. And then on top of this, the people that are still functioning in that system are almost always participating in jobs and companies and things that contribute to the destruction of our planet, to the destruction of other people, and to the destruction of themselves, because they're just looking for the bottom line dollar right now. All they're thinking about is security. So people still work for oil companies. People still work for the coal mining industry, like for coal and gas and all of these things that we know are destroying the planet. There are animal agriculture, and they won't look into it. They won't take responsibility because all they want is the money for themselves right now. And they work these jobs that they hate. So then it turns them into people who are emotionally suppressed and who have to go and drink and do drugs and have sex and have crazy addictions to TV and buying things. And, like, you know, they need this, like, ridiculous consumer society just to survive because they're so miserable in their shit and doing their day-to-day life that the only way they can get through it is to be self-destructive and therefore destructive to everybody else. So you see how this is not actually responsible? You see how not finding your passion, not coming into alignment with a state of love inside of yourself, letting go of this idea of security and moving into this idea of what's my passion? What do I have to offer? What do I have to give this world? What do I have that I love doing, that I can do in a way that where I don't have to drug myself or suppress myself or do anything negative or self-defeating to myself in order to get through it. You see how that is actually being a responsible adult. You see how what we think of as a responsible adult is someone who has numbed themselves to their needs, numbed themselves to who they are, numbed themselves to the effect that they have on the planet, and are just doing what they need to do for the bottom line for themselves right now. How that doesn't work. We need people who are awake, who are finding their passion, because when this happens, you can adapt. We need people to wake up because those are gonna be the people that are gonna be able to find new sources of energy that serve everybody. They're gonna be the innovators that make this world a sustainable place for us to live. So if you are not doing your work to find your passion, to figure out what you're here to do to serve yourself and humanity as a whole, you are not a responsible adult. It is not responsible to work a shit job so that you can have money to pay your bills and then retire. Look at where that's going. Look at what that has caused. It is your responsibility to find your passion because your authentic passion is going to be something that serves the aggregate. And you need to understand that. That's how it works. So if you have any questions, comments, concerns, please leave them down below. Like, subscribe, share, do all that fun stuff. Find me on Patreon, find me on Facebook, find me on Instagram. All those links are below. And just think about this. Think about how, if it is really actually truly responsible to completely abdicate your joy for money, right? Is that really responsible? And yeah, if you have